Thank you. Real pleasure to be here for the second time in 2 months amongst friends. And I always find these sorts of events very interesting because I always learn something new. I learned a lot of new stuff today from the previous speakers. So this talk is slightly not specifically related to game changers, but to try and help explain and for us to understand what really is at the root of this health misinformation, which is sort of so prevalent across healthcare that it is, you know, it's an epidemic now, and we need to do something to cure it. Stephen Hawking, the late great Stephen Hawking, said, "The greatest enemy of knowledge is not ignorance, it's the illusion of knowledge." And this next slide, and I know I mentioned this in my previous talk, which I did a month ago, but I promise there's a lot of new material for you coming up. I think this elegant concept really helps explain what we're all trying to achieve and why, you know, what areas of the system are creating barriers for people actually to have improved outcomes for us, for our families, for our patients. You know, we use our clinical expertise, best available evidence, and last but not least, patient values and expectations. And I'm very much, you know, in the same thinking as Georgia. You know, I believe in patient choice, but are patients getting the full information? Are the public getting full information to make those choices? And how far are we away from truly informed consent? David Sackett, who was one of the founders of the evidence-based medicine movement, also said that half of what you learn in medical school will be shown to be outdated or dead wrong within 5 years of your graduation. The trouble is nobody can tell you which half, so you have to learn on your own. Now, just coming back to this slide here, the best available clinical evidence, unfortunately, has been corrupted by commercial influence. And I think the one person in the world who's done more work than anyone to expose this is John Ioannidis, Professor of Medicine and Statistics at Stanford. And he wrote this really interesting paper called How to Survive the Medical Misinformation Mess. And he states these four major factors behind the fact that, in his view, his analysis, most published research is false. And by the way, we're talking about research within, you know, the pharmaceutical and medical device industries as well, where you have much more money, you have much more in terms of randomized controlled trials, and I'm going to illustrate a little bit about how those trials are even unreliable or potentially unreliable. But most of the published research is not reliable, offers no benefit to patients. This is another barrier. You know, don't assume your doctor knows this. Most healthcare professionals are not aware of this problem. They're not aware of it, they're not going to do anything about it. And they also lack the necessary skills to evaluate the reliability and usefulness of medical science. And then, you know, last of all, most importantly, the patients then also lack relevant, accurate medical evidence and skill guidance at the time of making those decisions. In his paper, Why Most Published Research Findings Are False, one of the factors behind it is the greater the financial and other prejudices in a scientific field, and that includes intellectual prejudice as well, the less likely the research findings are to be true. So in this epidemic of misinformed doctors and misinformed patients, there are seven sins put together by Gerd Gigerenzer from Max Planck Institute in Berlin and Muir Gray, and they cite that we've got this biased funding of research issue, so research that's funded for purposes of profit, not to benefit patients, the biased reporting in medical journals, biased patient pamphlets, biased reporting in the media. You know, I think Game Changers is one great example of that. Commercial conflicts of interest, defensive medicine, and also an inability of medical curricula actually do not teach. We are not trained to actually understand and then communicate statistics very well. It's not something I learned in medical school. It's something I only came across probably in the last 5 to 10 years of my career. Let's just pick a couple of examples. As a cardiologist, there's been a huge movement in the last 10, 15 years where people with heart disease are managed by having heart stents put in. So the financial influence for individual doctors to earn more based upon number of investigations and procedures can also put profits before patients. You know, from minority, greed smothers the conscience. One US cardiologist was jailed for ordering up to $19 million worth of unnecessary investigations and procedures. We have this fee-for-service model in the US as well, which also contributes to overuse, and I would argue is actually unethical because it takes away true informed consent if there's a financial incentive to prescribe drugs or a particular diet. In the UK, we have something similar, but not to the same degree. And just to give you an example, so it's, you know, independent analysis suggested up to half of all stents that were inserted, coronary stents for heart disease in the US, were inappropriate, which was costing US healthcare about $2.4 billion per year, which is pretty quite extraordinary. Despite the fact there is still a lot, you know, despite the fact the evidence shows that stenting does not improve prognosis, does not prevent heart attacks, does not prolong life. Despite that evidence, though, why were cardiologists still putting in so many stents? In fact, 88% of patients actually thought they're having the stent put in for the very purpose of preventing a heart attack, prolonging life, even though the evidence did not suggest that would be the case. And this is most extraordinary. When anonymously asked, 43% of cardiologists said they would still go ahead and do the procedure, even if they felt it would not benefit the patient. And this is not a procedure that doesn't come without risk. So I wrote two consecutive editorials, one in the BMJ and then one in JAMA Internal Medicine about this a few years ago, just to highlight that actually, at a very basic evidence-based medicine level, we should just communicate that information to patients. I think they would want to know that, and it would probably change the decision-making. And of course, this procedure does also carry a harm of 1% harm of it causing a heart attack, stroke, or death. So think about this, stents being put in with no benefit to prevent a heart attack, but 1 in 100 people will either suffer a heart attack, a stroke, or die as a result of the procedure. And of course, it also detracts from other things like lifestyle changes that people can institute to improve their quality of life. So anyway, the BMJ published my piece, and then JAMA Internal Medicine, it was press released, and then BBC News picked it up. I'm just giving an example about, even when that information gets out there, you have to, there are challenges also coming from those vested interests that, you know, make money or have a culture of doing those procedures. So this was, you know, it was a BBC News Online. I got some support from a very eminent doctor in the UK called Terence Stevenson, actually now chair of the General Medical Council. And he said it's a legitimate debate that, you know, what I'd written, that we should be transparent with patients. But the British Cardiovascular Intervention Society said there was no evidence in the UK that patients had been treated inappropriately. So think about that wording. No evidence that patients had been treated inappropriately. I said it should be mandatory on the consent form. I said every patient, the default option should be on the consent form, when they're having stents, they should be told lack of prognostic benefit. I trained as an interventional cardiologist. I did not need to tell patients that, but I did. All I needed to tell them on the consent form was, we are treating your heart disease, and there was a 1% risk of heart attack, stroke, and death. There was no mention at all of telling them there was no prognostic benefit. And interestingly, so they said there was no evidence of inappropriate treatment. Coincidentally, JAMA Internal Medicine then published a study a few months later where they gave this scenario to see would it change the decision-making process, and it did. In fact, instead of 70% of patients opting for a stent, it got reduced to 45%. And they calculated in US healthcare, if this conversation was to take place in every consultation between a cardiologist and patient, which, to be honest, is not a long, difficult conversation. It takes me about 30 seconds to explain this to a patient. It would save US healthcare $864 million per year. This is just one part of a whole healthcare system that can be improved just by being transparent with information. Now, doctors' misunderstanding of health statistics is also a risk factor. Many doctors actually do not understand health statistics, which you may find very surprising, and therefore cannot evaluate the evidence for and against a treatment. So a study of 150 consultant, you know, attending gynecologists, a third of them did not understand the meaning of a 25% risk reduction created by breast cancer screening, by mammography. When asked, they actually thought you had to, if you screened 1,000 women for breast cancer, that 25% risk reduction meant you would save 250 women from breast cancer in terms of they'll be, you know, detected and operated on. But the actual data shows from a Cochrane analysis of 500,000 women that you'd save one life for every 2,000 people screened. In other words, what should be said in that consultation if a patient asked, should I get breast cancer screening? In general, what the doctor should be saying to the patient is, if we screen you, there's a 1 in 2,000 chance that it will save your life. What was missed, though, later on in a smaller study, is the harms of screening. The harms of screening were also not discussed. And it's interesting that you would actually have 10 times more patients suffering a harm from an inappropriate treatment or an unnecessary operation because of a misdiagnosis of breast cancer. So actually, that transparent communication conversation should be 1 in 2,000 chance it may, you know, save you, it will save your life, but there's you're 10 times more likely, or a 10 in 2,000 chance, 1 in 200, you will suffer an unnecessary harm. And that should be how we should be communicating with patients. I'm just going to very quickly just you know, the relative risk, absolute risk issue is also still a big deal when it comes to how we communicate information to patients. As you know, in nutritional epidemiology, in a lot of these studies, we talk about relative risk. It sounds very exaggerated in terms of, you know, association of meat and cancer or heart disease, et cetera. But you know, relative risk communication exaggerates the benefits. And just one example, which I'm going to give you here, is that if you look at a randomized trial of people taking statins with type 2 diabetes, the relative risk reduction is 48% over 4 years from taking a statin. What does that actually mean? Well, if you look at the trial data, instead of 28 in 1,000 people having a stroke on the placebo drug, 15 in 1,000 who took a statin suffered a stroke. Therefore, you've saved 13 people out of 1,000, which is 1.3% or 1 in 77. So the transparent, honest way, easy to understand way of communicating that information is to tell the patient, if you take this statin religiously and we trust the data completely, then there's a 1 in 77 chance you will be prevented from having a stroke. And then medical journals, unfortunately, have mismatched framing. So a third of medical journal articles published between 2004 and 2006 in the JAMA, BMJ, and the Lancet actually use relative risk when they were showing the benefits of a drug and use absolute risk in the harms, which is just absolutely ridiculous. And of course, this then biases, you know, in favor of prescription versus not prescribing medications. And then, you know, don't just take my word for it. This is a World Health Organization bulletin from Gergi Gorenza, 2009. He said it's an ethical imperative that every patient doctor understand the difference to protect patients from unnecessary anxiety manipulation between relative and absolute risk. But this is not part of regular clinical practice. Now, let's just take a step back a second. We're talking about, you know, nutritional epidemiology, lack of funding for you know, lack of independent funding for good quality randomized trials. Although, as you know, Sarah has already said, I think in food studies, even that is going to be challenging to some degree. So Peter Wilmses is a cardiologist who's done a lot of work over the years investigating medical fraud, looking at research, exposing research misconduct, and in a lecture he gave at the Center of Evidence-Based Medicine in Oxford in 2014, he makes this very crucial point that we need to all acknowledge when it comes to how we think about what's going on in the healthcare system. So pharmaceutical companies actually have a fiduciary obligation as businesses to make a profit and therefore and sell their product. They are not required, although most of us would hope or believe this to be the case, they are not required actually to give you the best treatment. But the real scandal is that regulators fail to prevent misconduct by industry, and that doctors, institutions, and medical journals collude with industry for financial gain. They are responsible for scientific integrity and for patients, duty to patients, but what they're doing is they're colluding with industry for financial gain. Now, more recently, Peter Wilmses then submitted more evidence to Parliament because they did an inquiry into research misconduct. They wanted a review of it. And he makes, you know, what is the root of this issue with commercial influence over medical science? So, academic institutions bear responsibility for the pressure to publish, for career advancement, and that can result in research misconduct. If you get a prominent publication, you're more likely to attract future funding, which institutions demand, and good publicity, which institutions desire. Other pressures for misconduct come from associations with industry, with these institutions, when investigators or their institutions hold patents or shares, and they receive payments from industry. So there's also financial pressure to publish research that will be profitable for the company and to suppress negative findings. He says some publications are simply organized criminal activities. When prominent academics are paid large sums of money to publish false data by industry, or a sponsor may be one of the victims when payments for conducting research are made to investigators who simply fabricate data. Medical journals also, we should not forget this, medical journals also have financial pressures to publish positive findings on drugs and medical devices because their manufacturers buy reprints of those publications, which they can then go and market and use as marketing material in hospitals and give to doctors, which is used, you know, we believe as medical professionals all this time, this is gospel truth, this is good science. And in fact, you know, in some cases, they can you know, pay hundreds of thousands of pounds or dollars to a medical journal just for one publication, which may well be false. And therefore, the medical journal also takes money, you know, and that keeps the medical journal running, et cetera. So this is a bias in the research interface as well. To protect their reputations, academic institutions will often conceal research misconduct, destroy evidence, and silence whistleblowers. Journals are reluctant to admit they publish flawed research, so they commonly refuse to publish failures to replicate. Now, this is where the law is also not in our favor. The law is on the side of the corporates, because fear of libel action contributes to the failure to expose research misconduct. So whistleblowers are more, you know, reluctant to come out because they are afraid of legal action that may be taken against them, even if what they're saying is absolutely correct. And because of these lenient sanctions, institutions believe that misconduct is not very serious and research fraudsters are not deterred. And what Peter Wilmshurst concludes, and I think I agree with him, that the best way to address these problems of research misconduct would be by making these serious forms of misconduct criminal offences with meaningful sanctions. Now, just to give you another example of how things can go very, very wrong, and this I don't think was financially, you know, there wasn't a financial root cause behind this. This was basically about prestige, power of publication. One researcher in Holland, a cardiologist, was found guilty of fabricating research on the use of beta blocker drugs in non-cardiac surgery. And once this was exposed, and all these so-called articles, which took time to be retracted, it actually, his research influenced European Society of Cardiology guidelines. An independent analysis then calculated that because of his research misconduct, there was probably 800,000 excess deaths in Europe across 8 years. This is just one level of research misconduct that's been exposed. That is absolutely extraordinary. Now, this was not widely publicized. You know, why does everybody not know this? If everybody knew this, people would not be, they would want to know what is at the root of it, and then we'd try and correct the system failures that we've got. In terms of research, when actually the pharmaceutical industry, the medical device industry are found guilty of conducting, you know, illegal marketing of drugs, hiding data on harms, nothing really happens. Peter Gosha wrote this article in the BMJ. He's one of the co-founders of the Cochrane Collaboration. And between 2009 and 2014, most of the top 10 pharmaceutical companies paid fines close to $13 billion for fraud, basically. Now, what was interesting is, despite that, nothing seems to have changed. No one got fired, no one lost their job. GSK is one company that were found guilty of, they paid the largest amount, I think $3 billion in that time period for illegally marketing and hiding data on harms on four drugs. But again, there were no real meaningful sanctions imposed. And they made $25 billion in profit during the period covered by the settlement. So what Peter Gosha says is, you know, if crime pays, you commit more crime. We have this innovation crisis in drugs as well. So 667 new drugs approved by the FDA between 2000 and 2008. Only 11% were actually truly innovative. Most of them were basically copies of old ones. Drug companies change a few molecules around. They then market these drugs. By the time someone's worked out the new drug is no better than the old one, they've made their money, they're off patent, they go, the cycle continues. Marcia Angel, former editor of the New England Journal of Medicine, considered the highest impact medical journal in the world. She herself says it's no longer possible to trust most of the published research or rely on the authority of medical guidelines, and she really reached this conclusion very reluctantly after almost two decades as editor of the New England Journal of Medicine. Richard Horton, another editor, said possibly half of the published research is untrue. He wrote this in an online editorial for The Lancet, 2015. And Richard Smith wrote in the BMJ, he's former editor of the BMJ, he actually, talking about research misconduct, he actually gave a lecture somewhere to several academics, and he asked the audience, he said, you know, this is all anonymized, but how many of you in your career are aware of research misconduct going on in your department or have witnessed it? Manipulation, fabrication of data, whatever. He said a third to a half of the audience put their hand up. He then said, how many of you reported it? Everybody put their hand down. So what can we do about all of this? Well, I think one of the simple steps, I was involved in some of my private advocacy work. I worked with the medical royal colleges and, you know, spent about a year with them explaining all of these issues. And we started something called the Choosing Wisely campaign in the UK, basically to try and wind back the harms of too much medicine and essentially say that this is a big healthcare system problem. We've only got finite resources where we need to use them better. It's more ethical to do so. And we talk about the fact that really increasing information and better data is crucial through medical education, through the system. Patients should be encouraged to ask questions when they go to see the doctor about whether they really need a test or procedure, what are the risks, are there simpler, safer options? And that's where I think things like prescribing people walking, you know, doing more exercise, joining CrossFit, eating real food, that's where this comes in, and a lot of people's health improves when they do that. And of course, medical schools also need to ensure that students develop a good understanding of medical literature and be able to critically evaluate research in a way that people here are able to do very effectively. This needs to be widespread. Everybody should be empowered. Every doctor should be empowered to be able to analyze research as good as Zoe or Georgia, you know, or Sarah, you know, Gary. We need that kind of this needs to be, you know, mainstream part of medical education. I'll just clip go forward very quickly. I'm almost finished, literally 30 seconds. There's also an environmental impact of too many drugs as well. We're now seeing that, you know, this is affecting, you know, wildlife. It's affecting sea life because of all the drugs that's going into the water supply from all of the overconsumption. Now, my personal view, having been in this for, you know, a few years, this again is a gross injustice being committed on the public, on doctors. And the way to change the system is make that injustice visible. Now, I think the best way, the only one of the ways to do this is really to have a full public inquiry, you know, involving you know, Congress in the UK Parliament, for example. This is what needs to happen. I wrote this in The Guardian and made the case for that. And for me, when I, you know, when everybody knows of these system failures, when everybody knows that a stent doesn't prevent a heart attack, you know, then we can really have better quality care for patients. So when I walk into a coffee shop, if the barista serving me says to me, do you know that most published research is false? I know we're winning, right? I know we're winning. Then we can change the system. The preservation of the means of knowledge amongst the lowest ranks is more important to the public than all the problems. This is about real transparency. It's actually about democracy. Yesterday I spoke in LA and I said, and I'm going to say this again today, and I said it yesterday, I took a bit of a risk. The way the system is at the moment, the way the pharmaceutical industry and the food industry function, the way they've controlled information, they are enemies of democracy in my view. And this should make people angry. And once it does, once they realize what's going on, we can really change the system. Thank you.